Well, it's been an interesting day, hasn't it? I mean, nowadays you can actually buy, you know, Happy International Women's Day cards. Not quite a Hallmark message, but, you know, everybody's in on it, aren't they? Everybody's got their tweet. The multinational companies, I've had numerous things from florists saying, send your favorite woman a bunch of roses or something like that. But despite the attempts, and I mean, it's part of how high profile it is. In many ways, it reflects the interest. But despite that, it's not really what's defined today. What is brilliant about what is defined today is the sense that there is struggle, there is resistance, and there is women fighting back. I mean, I hear, and I mean, obviously news from America is still coming in because of the time lag, that teachers have walked out in some schools in Philadelphia against Trump. That other teachers in Maryland and in other places, they've actually said, we're all requesting leave today. Perhaps they didn't have the confidence to walk out, but at least they're doing that and shutting down some schools. And actually, in Ireland today, magnificent, they shut down O'Connell Bridge, thousands marched through the city centre, demanding the repeal of the 8th, which I'm sure many of you know what that is. It's a part of the Irish Constitution that equates the pregnant woman with an embryo from the moment of conception. And these people who say they care so much about the so-called unborn baby, these are the same hypocrites who allow thousands of babies of women who didn't happen to be married to end up being buried in mass graves in Tuam and other mother and baby homes across Ireland. That's the hypocrisy of these people who say they care. But I think, and also there was almost 1,000 at the Irish embassy here, so good, there's solidarity, you know, on this side of the Irish Sea as well. But we've never seen anything like this in many ways. And if you think, you know, across the world also today, interestingly, and I'll come back to this, there are some of the poorest women and working class women in Egypt in the streets of Cairo and Alexandria marching in protest on bread prices. Now, you may feel like that's a bit of a time lag, you know, 100 years ago, but that is what's happening. And I think if you think about the protests that we're seeing in Ireland and other places, and what we have seen over the last 6 months in Poland and Ireland again, and after Trump's inauguration on his first day in office, millions marched across the globe, every continent, every country, towns and cities, people marched. I mean, who would have thought that pink knitted pussy hats would be the symbol of resistance against the sexist, bulliest US president? I certainly couldn't have predicted it. But that sight of something of which has put women's reproductive rights and women's rights in general at the center of resistance on a scale we haven't seen for a generation really is what the threat, people understand the threat of Trump and what it means. And that, you know, Trump has declared war on a lot of people, hasn't he? Refugees, migrants, but he and Pence, let's remember his vice president, have absolutely declared war on women's bodies and women's rights. And this isn't, you know, I'm not one of these people that writes off Trump as an idiot, and I'm sure nobody else in here would, because he's not. His politics, and particularly attacking who he's attacking, goes right down of the right-wing populist ideas where he comes from. And actually, he's not alone. He's not some aberration of some nutty US president. We see it reflected in other countries in Europe. No time to go into that now, but it means that we can't be complacent about what is happening nearer to home. And I think that sense of the possibilities that there are there, it shows us that today, a day we celebrate struggle, solidarity, strikes, that's what International Women's Day is about, not a Hallmark message. And of course, as Nayla said, today marks the day of the beginning of the Russian Revolution, began by women. Interestingly, even The Guardian and some of these places are having to acknowledge the real roots of International Women's Day, really, because before they didn't bother. They just said, oh, it's a day for women to celebrate inspiring individuals. Well, yeah, there is some inspiring individuals, and we can mention some here, can't we? Alexander Kollontai, Clara Zetkin, many other revolutionaries. But the inspiring women are really the textile workers who poured out of their factories on International Women's Day in 1917, when even the Bolsheviks were saying, oh, no, maybe it's a bit too soon, we're not quite ready. Maybe we should just hang on, you know. They ignored them and went for it and marched out of the factories and threw snowballs at the factories where other workers, male and female, were in saying, get out with us, strike with us. And when the police tried to block the bridges, they slid down the ice and walked along the river on the ice in order to get to other factories until thousands and thousands came out and strike. And it began something that started as a protest and strike, started it as International Women's Day for bread and peace, and actually began the process of a revolution. I mean, we're told, aren't we, that the Russian Revolution was a coup and it was all about anti-democratic politics and all the rest of it. I mean, really nothing could be further from the truth. I mean, we're here today to say what genuine revolutions are festivals of the oppressed. And that is the measure of a genuine revolution. That's how you can see whether it is one or not. If it's just about swapping a few faces at the top, then you don't see that flowering from below of all oppressed groups in the way that you did in Russia. And, you know, women had been active not before 1917. They were part of the revolutionary strands in Russia. And there had been another revolution in 1905. And Alexandra Kollontai, she commented about 1905. And she said, there was no corner in which one way or another the voice of a woman speaking about herself and demanding new rights was not heard. So they were central to this movement right from the very start. And the Tsarist dictatorship was terrified of women workers. One SARS official said that they were a store of combustible material. How true that is. You know, the BA worker who had to go. You know, you have got combustible material, haven't you? When you've got the oppressed sections of the working class when they use their collective power to fight back. And, you know, Trotsky, when he was writing about it at the beginning, he talked about how the textile workers were the most oppressed and downtrodden of the proletariat, and they were overcame, and he admitted it, the resistance of its own revolutionary organisations in order to come out that day. And in fact, you know, the revolutionary left had to run to catch up with the class. It's not the case that revolutionary organisations are always ahead of the class and dictating terms and telling people what to do. Far from it. The genuine revolutionary movement learns from the class and is rooted in the class, and often the class can leap in front of it in terms of the struggle. And I think that sense of how that began a process, I mean, you know, it was only a week and the Tsar was gone. I mean, when it came to Egypt, it was 18 days before Mubarak went. You know, the speed of events when ordinary people take the stage of history is really phenomenal. It takes everybody by surprise. And, you know, the people at the top more than anybody, because we're always fighting for those moments, but even we can be taken back. And I think that when you look at what was achieved in Russia, and we've got to remember, you know, women's oppression in Russia in 1917, it was a brutal business. You know, the whip that a husband could hang above the marital bed was so he could whip his wife if she didn't obey him. And now it was only allowed to be no bigger than the circumference of his thumb. So that's okay then, isn't it? Yeah, you have a skinny husband, it's only a thin whip. But the fact is, that was part and parcel of life for many peasant families. And if you think of the housework, this wasn't spinning around with a broom and, you know, a hoover or whatever, and, you know, shoving things in a washing machine. Back-breaking work in the home in those days. And many, many women illiterate. And so therefore the sense of the determination that the Bolshevik Party had to win women both before and during the revolution to the revolutionary process was something that was they knew was fundamental to the revolution. That's why the ruling class were so scared, because they also knew a united revolution that women were part of was something that they could, that they would find hard to beat. And that sense of what they did, and one of the key things that the Bolsheviks understood was the material burden of oppression was in the home, was in the family, and what women had to carry. While that was still there, then it was difficult for women to play a full role in society in general, let alone in the struggle. And therefore, the nurseries and the restaurants or canteens and all of the things that they tried to put in place in what was a fledgling revolution really shows the commitment to that. And I think then also they set up a women's department, the Zemital, which sent women thousands of miles across this vast country to win people to the revolution in some of the most remote places. And they brought agi trains, agi ships. They showed projections, films, some of the new technology of the moment. You know, it was their Twitter of today, was to bring films to win people who were illiterate. They also had literacy cabins with blackboards so that women could learn to read and write and be able to understand all the vast outpourings of literature and debates on the political agenda at the time. And I think this is something that feels so inspiring, you know, that they wore little red scarves, you know, and villages and towns everywhere, the female Bolsheviks came around and fighting for the revolution. And in many of the areas where Muslim-majority areas, Bolshevik women would put on a hijab so they could go and win women and talk to them about politics. The notion that the revolution ripped the hijab from people comes from Stalin's time, comes from the defeat of the revolution, comes from after the revolution, something that is worth remembering when we hear all those stereotypes. And Lenin said, one of the leaders of the revolution said a year after, how proud he was of what the revolution had achieved. He said, take the position of woman. In this field, not a single democratic party in the world Not even the most advanced bourgeois republic has done in decades so much as a hundredth part of what we did in our very first year in power. We really raised to the ground the infamous laws placing women in a position of inequality, restricting divorce and surrounding with disgusting formalities, denying recognition to children born out of wedlock. That was in 1918, and they were still denying those rights to people born out of wedlock in Britain and in Ireland right through until the 1960s. And enforcing a search for their fathers, etc. Laws, numerous survivals of which, to the shame of the bourgeoisie and of capitalism, are to be found in all civilized countries. That's still true today. There's many so-called advanced countries, etc., that still haven't done a hundredth part of what the revolution achieved and was attempting to achieve in those early days. Full social and political equality for women, the right to vote, the right to hold public office, the right to divorce at the request of either partner. When Trotsky was asked at the time if it was true that in Russia now that you could have a divorce just by asking, he said, "Is it true there are countries where this still isn't the case?" Such is the nonsense of the things that are imposed on us. But the principle of equal pay, we didn't get that until 1970 in Britain. Paid maternity leave before and after childbirth, childcare at the government's expense, abortion on demand in state hospitals. We still don't have that in Britain. It's still a criminal offence, and you can only have an abortion if you fulfil certain conditions of the 67 Act, and actually mostly they're done by private clinics, even though the NHS pays. But abortion on request and demand is not a right we have here, and is also not a right we have in the US. And homosexuality was decriminalised. Well, we didn't get that until 67 here either, and that was only above the age of 21. So if you go through the list of the things they achieved, it's absolutely phenomenal. Phenomenal. That's the power of a revolution. Now, of course, the other half of the story is what happened to the revolution, its defeat, the crushing of it. I'm sure, you know, we can talk more about that. But I think what we have to look, what I think is so fascinating about the Bolsheviks is that they helped understand and identify when the revolution was being defeated, when it was being rolled back by the position of women. It wasn't just some abstract thing about class forces. It was understanding even little things that, to be honest, were almost invisible. That women weren't taking their clothes to the laundries, the public laundries anymore, because the clothes were getting torn and lost. That women were starting to cook at home again instead of using the communal restaurants because the food wasn't good enough. Now, these are things that, you know, should they have mattered to the people who led the Red Army and led the Soviets? But of course they did, because it mattered. It meant that women were going back to the old slavery, as Lenin put it, or as Trotsky put it. That sense of going back to the home, going back to domestic slavery, meant they were getting pulled out of the revolution. It meant the revolution was being pushed back, the achievements. And I think that's something absolutely to remember, that women's liberation, the festival of the oppressed aspect, wasn't just a sort of icing on the cake part of a revolution. It's fundamental to if it can win or not. And we have to remember when we're talking about this today, this isn't just about history 100 years ago. Russia opened the 20th revolution, the 20th century. Well, the 21st century was opened with revolutions as well, wasn't it? Tunisia and Egypt in 2011. I was lucky enough to report for Socialist Worker from Tahrir Square during the 18 days. And oh boy, you knew that was a genuine revolution, because in the midst of it were the most oppressed, the poorest, and women at the center, and actually ethnic and racial and religious groups all mixed. It is not a myth that Muslims linked arms to surround Christians of prayer and vice versa to make sure that the army didn't break them up. Women were at the center, Jewish people marching with their signs. There was a sense of unity that only a genuine popular social revolution can bring about. And I think that sense of it, I mean, Mahinur al-Masri, who is a leading revolutionary socialist in Egypt, who spent months in prison, only released earlier this year, what she said it did to people, the revolution, she said, "You can feel how the revolution has changed people. They have become mighty and courageous. They don't feel inferior anymore." Now, when revolution, the first 18 days finished and Mubarak fell, that wasn't the end. Just as February 2017 wasn't the end, it's the beginning. Revolution is not an event, it's a process that can take weeks, months, or years. But very quickly, the thugs, the government thugs, the ruling class thugs, who did they first attack? once Mubarak had fallen, to try to regain power. It was women, International Women's Day, in Tahrir Square, the symbol of the revolution. Thugs went in and attacked women who went there to celebrate International Women's Day in 2011. That was because they wanted to break the revolution. They wanted to break the unity. And they've done this at all the revolutions in Yemen and elsewhere, because they thought, if we can break women from the revolution, if we can intimidate them off the streets, if we can make them scared to be part of the revolution, then they can push it back and beat it. And I mean, you know, clearly what's happened is they have, and the counter-revolution in Egypt is in the ascendancy. There's no pretending that. It's very, very tough for revolutionaries now, and very, very tough for workers, but they still continue to fight because they haven't gone quite back in the box. It's not back to the old days in lots of ways. Some of it's harsher in terms of what the state is doing, but also they've tasted freedom. They've tasted the possibility. They've had that feeling of not feeling inferior. They may be scared, but they don't feel inferior at the moment, and there's a big difference about that. The people who are scared is the ruling class. And when I say they were scared about women joining the revolutions, I mean, you know, they are terrified of anything. I mean, look at our ruling class in the right wing about having a socialist who leads the Labour Party. They're in, you know, paroxysms, aren't they? It's like everything they can do to attack Jeremy Corbyn, because they just can't believe there's a socialist, a man who calls himself a socialist, leading the opposition in Parliament. It's like, you know, imagine what they'd be like if we were leading a mass popular revolution. I think that's what's so interesting is that, well, you know, let's be real as well. Actually, he isn't just being attacked from the right. Disgracefully, Corbyn is also being attacked by some on the left. But I think that sense of, you know, where does power lie and how can we change things? Because even if we did get Jeremy Corbyn elected, you know, would that be enough to fundamentally transform British society, to get rid of capitalism, to bring socialism? He's a good guy, and I back him against the right and all the rest of it. But actually, we know that one person isn't enough. That change, the green benches of Parliament are not where power lies. Power lies more like when the NHS demonstration on Saturday, doesn't it? Where you see protesters and trade union members marching together to defend the health service. And I think that's what we have to look at. How do we change things? Because we can't look to the top. And for some people to go around saying it's about men hanging on to power, no, there's plenty of women leaders around at the moment who are hanging on to power, isn't there? I mean, you know, Marine Le Pen. Are we going to look to her? Are we going to look to Angela Merkel? What about just, you know, where I'm from, Arlene Foster, DUP leader? Are we going to look to her for change? I don't think so. And let alone our own Theresa May. I mean, when Theresa May went running to Trump as soon as he was elected, she said, I don't need to address his sexism, because me being a woman leader going to meet him will be enough to challenge him. Okay, so when they were pictured holding hands in the White House, what do people here feel about that? What do you think people in Mississippi, where there's only one abortion clinic open, what do you think those women felt like? What do you think the women around the world who are gonna face backstreet dangerous abortions because of the gag order by Trump, what do you think they felt like when they saw him and her holding hands? Did they think, go for it, sister, you've really done it for them? Oh, yay. Of course they didn't. We can't rely on these people. Class will out, and that's what the difference makes. And I think that sense of working class woman and the difference. I mean, Clara Zetkin, a fantastic revolutionary, she talked about how the liberation of working class women is different than the liberation or the struggles of ruling class women. And she says the end goal of working class women is not free competition with the men of their class, but bringing the political rule of the whole working class. And therefore, she's fighting against capitalist society. Theresa May suffers sexism, and they do, but they're not wanting to fight to get rid of capitalism. Their interests lie in maintaining capitalism, even if they pay a price of discrimination as being women. And I think that's the difference. And how Clara Zetkin put it, she said, to be sure, working class women concur with the demands of bourgeois women's movement. They want to fight against sexism, they want equality, but those demands, they're fighting for those as a means to an end, so that she can get into battle along with working men and equally armed. I love that phrase. She doesn't mean with a Kalashnikov or anything. She means women have to go into battle equally armed with men in terms of politically, ideologically, organisationally. Part of the collective power of the working class is how they can challenge it. Because only as a class, using our collective power, can we challenge oppression. It isn't the case. Working class women don't have the option of buying a nanny, of paying for a private, safe abortion, or any of these things. Working class women don't have those personal lifestyle alternatives to choose. Actually, they have to fight as a collective in order to win games. And I think this is something that we see time and again when collective power is being used. But we've seen movements before. We've seen revolutions, as we've described, but they haven't won. Well, they're being pushed back. We've seen mass movements against racism and for civil rights, mass movements against war. How do we make sure that next time these things happen, we win? And I think this is where we have to see that lead for organisation, it's not just enough about spontaneity. Spontaneity is a spark, it's absolutely vital, and it happens, struggles happen, blow out, whatever goes on. But it's about organisation. And you know, that's why, you know, we've got a Socialist Workers' Party. That's why you see us everywhere. You see us on Saturday with our placards and our paper. You see us on picket lines, small or large. That's why we have a BA striker here. That's why we see struggle as key. But not just that, we don't cheer from the sidelines. We want to organize and maximize every struggle. I mean, that's what the Bolsheviks understood. Because victory is not inevitable. Victory is actually almost made in advance of the revolts in terms of what we build as socialist organization. I think that's absolutely vital. So we have to celebrate the Russian Revolution and the potential that it gave. What it turned into was a grotesque caricature and something that we have no, you know, we cheered its collapse in the end. But out of war, out of exploitation and horror, the revolution was a beautiful thing. And I think that's what we see. It was a beacon of hope right across the world. And you know, this was before Twitter, TV, mobile phones, and yet the word Bolshe, short for Bolshevik, traveled across Europe, other revolutions, right into the trenches of northern France, where the soldiers led mutinies against their officers. Bolshe was something to be proud of. Bolshe traveled. We're Bolshes. We're in that tradition. The BA striker, Helen, she's in that tradition. And we want to be Bolshes. And I think that sense of how do we fight back? And it isn't just about intransigent opposition to oppression and exploitation. Yes, that's what we are as the SWP, but it's about how do we build an organisation that can actually not just say another world is possible, but and treat it like a pipe dream, like a utopia, but say another world is possible and we know how we can fight for it. And I think that sense of the Russian Revolution 1917 was proof that another world is possible. The Egyptian Revolution of 2011 is proof that another world is possible. But if you're sitting there thinking, well, how will we make sure they win next time? The key is not to think you're just going to be a spectator. Because I know what it's like. You can sit in front of the TV and the news is on. You can be, you know, because you can be a spectator today. The television, you know, the revolution is televised. It's tweeted. It's live streamed on Facebook. You can be a consumer very easily and just be shouting at the telly. Bastard. What a smug bastard. Look at his orange face. How could he do this? It's not good enough. Because actually, if we're going to make sure we win, then we have to get organized. And we need all of you for that. I think, you know, as Howard Zinn, the wonderful socialist historian in America, he said, you can't be neutral on a moving train. You can't be moving neutral on a moving train. You've got to take sides. You've got to jump in. And I hope that those of you who are here who want to see us win next time will join us, join the struggle, and maybe, just maybe, next time we can change the world.